Using layer and composition markers to trigger animations is a great way to easily recycle simple animations or complex nested animations in another composition. Sometimes you may want to reuse a single animation on the same property. This technique allows you to change a property value at a specific point in time by placing a marker on a layer. You can also name the markers to trigger a variety of simple property value changes. Let's make the planet fade in and out at a specific point in time using markers. So with the planet layer highlighted, press T on your keyboard to open opacity. Add a new expression and begin the first line with a variable called fade frames, capital F. Follow this with an equal sign and a value of 10, and then close the line with a semicolon. Now this is the number of frames that your animation will interpolate across. Now on the same line, you can add a new variable called M, followed by an equal sign, and set this to a value of 0. This sets the initial number of layer markers for the expression. And finally, include another variable on the same line, T, followed by an equal sign, and set this value to time, and then semicolon. The T variable will represent time until we redefine it later. Now on the next line, start a conditional statement with if, open parenthesis, and then you can type marker, period operator, num keys, num keys, capital K, greater than symbol, a zero, and then a close parenthesis. And then at the end of this, start an open curly bracket. Now because this is a multi-line conditional statement, we're going to leave the curly bracket at the end of this line, go to the next line, and indent two spaces. On this line, we're going to redefine M to represent the nearest keyframe. So start with another M variable, followed by an equal sign, and then we'll use marker again, period operator, and then we'll search for the nearest key. So nearest key, capital K, and then open parenthesis, time, close parenthesis. After that, a period operator, and then index, and then end the line with a semicolon. So this line is looking for the nearest marker to the current time, and then redefines the M variable as the marker's index. On the next line, indent two spaces, and then create a new variable called tag, and then an equal sign, and then marker, period operator, key, open parenthesis, M, close parenthesis, period operator, comment, and then end this line with a semicolon. This line finds the marker specified in M and then assigns the marker's comment to the tag variable. On the next line, indent two spaces and then start a new conditional statement. So start with if and then open parenthesis, and then we're looking for the contents of tag, double equal sign, open double quotation, in with a capital I, and then close double quotation. After this, you can close it with a close parenthesis and then open a curly bracket. And then we can redefine T equal sign to the marker, period operator, key, open parenthesis, M, close parenthesis, period operator, time, minus, time, close curly bracket. This line checks to see if the nearest marker's comment matches in, and if so, it defines T as the gap between the marker and the current time. The next line will do the same, but it's going to look for a marker without as the comment. So indent two spaces and then start with else if, and then open parenthesis, tag, double equal sign, open double quotation, out with a capital O, close double quotation, and then close parenthesis, open curly bracket, T equals time minus marker, period operator, key, open parenthesis, M, close parenthesis, and then period operator, time, close curly bracket. So this line is looking for a marker with a comment of out, and then it defines T as the current time minus the marker's time. So the next line assembles everything together in a linear method. So indent twice, and then linear, open parenthesis, T as the input, comma, the beginning of the range is gonna be 0, comma, and then frames, 2, capital T, time, capital T, open parenthesis, fade frames, capital F, which is our value from before, and then close parenthesis, comma, and then the beginning of the output is going to be value, comma, and then 0, close parenthesis. So this linear method evaluates the value change of T across the fade frame's value, and then animates from 0 to the original property value. So on the next line, we're going to end this statement with a close curly bracket. So this concludes the if statement. And finally, we just want to set a fallback, so else, open curly bracket, value, close curly bracket. Now if I click away from the expression, nothing's going to happen immediately because we don't have any layer markers. So if I highlight planet, and then if I navigate to the top level menu under layer, and then come down about halfway and you'll see add marker. So if you click that, it's going to add a layer marker to the selected layer. And now if you put your mouse directly over it and double click, you'll get a layer marker dialog box. And by default, the cursor is already in the comment box. And you can make this the beginning of the fade in, so in capital I, and then hit OK. So now you see that this marker has been labeled with in, but the planet is still at 100% opacity. And that's because the marker is at the very beginning of the composition. But if I click and drag on this marker and drag it forward in time, you'll notice now the planet has disappeared. And now you see that the planet fades in over 10 frames right here before the 1 second mark. So that's pretty cool. I can change the fade frames from 10 to something like 30 and then click away from the expression. And now if you preview, you'll see a nice smooth transition from 0 to 100 opacity across 30 frames. Okay, so now that we have the fade in, let's go ahead and add a fade out. I'm going to come to second 4 and I'm going to highlight the planet layer. I have an extended keyboard, so I can just hit the asterisk on the numpad to add a layer marker. And now you can see the planet's disappeared, but that's because this marker doesn't have a comment. So if I double click and in the comment box type out capital O and then come and hit OK. Now this marker has out applied to the label and the planet is back. And if I preview from this point, you'll see that now the planet fades out of view. Now for this opacity fade, it probably would have been pretty easy to keyframe this manually. The benefit you get with these markers is the ability to drag them around very easily without selecting keyframes. You also have the ability to add more markers along the timeline. And now you have multiple fade in and outs without a single keyframe on the timeline. You can take the layer markers method a step further and create a series of pre-built, complex, nested animations that are triggered with corresponding markers. This is a technique that's borrowed from Dan Ebbert's Mark Sync expression on motionscript.com, so be sure to visit him and send him a thank you if you find this technique useful. So in this composition, you'll see a rocket layer. It's a little different than the rocket layer in other lessons because the rocket is a nested composition instead of a shape layer. So if you come over to the timeline and double click on the rocket, it's going to open it in a separate composition. Now if you preview the composition, you'll see a couple nested animations with the fin and the flame and even a laser that shoots out. Each of these animations happens one time and they're about a second apart from each other. If I hit U to reveal all keyframes, you'll see that the first second in time is pretty static, and then across the next second you have the fins close and then they open again. And then the flame grows larger, and then it gets smaller, and then the laser shoots. Each of these animations happens one time, and then it returns to the original state. If you need complex variations of a scene, you can have multiple layers of this method. It's all up to how much flexibility and complexity you desire. So inside the rocket composition, you have some pre-built animations, and we know that each animation is 1 second in length. To access these stages, we have to link them to markers. Now an easy way to do this is to create a blank null layer at the top of the composition. My favorite way to do this without adding unnecessary solids to the project panel is to double click the shape layer and then delete the contents. This essentially creates a null for me, but it hasn't created any additional assets. Now I can rename the shape layer to markers, hit enter, and then hit U to collapse this up. Now I'm going to hit U so I can see the keyframes really quick. And I'm going to highlight the marker layer. Now first you want to add a marker at the very beginning to specify the base stage. So with markers highlighted, I'm going to go to layer, add marker, and then come down and double click the marker. And I'm gonna name this Rocket, capital R. Now when I hit okay, it's gonna add the label here. I'm gonna come to 1 second and do the same thing, layer, add marker, double click to rename. And this animation has the rocket fins closing. So I'm just gonna call it fin close and then hit okay. I'm gonna come to second two where the fins have already been closed and they're getting ready to open up and go to layer, add marker, double click, fin open and then hit okay. I'm gonna come to second three and this is where the flame grows larger. I'm gonna go to layer, add marker, double click, flame grow, hit okay. Do the same thing for number four, layer, add marker, double click, flame, shrink. Really creative names, huh? And then come to second five, layer, add marker, double click. I'm gonna call this laser shoot and then hit okay. So this markers layer is gonna be our reference for all the animation stages. So I'm gonna click outside and then hit U to collapse everything up. And then I'm done with this composition, so I'm gonna close it. And now we're back in our main composition. So now to properly link these two together, we need to add some markers here in this composition. So I'm gonna come to second two, and with rocket selected, I'm gonna go to layer, add marker, double click. I'm just gonna get it started with fin close. That'll be our first test animation. I'm gonna hit okay. So now you need to actually apply the markers expression to see it in action. This is a pretty complex expression to write step by step in this lesson, so I'm just gonna walk through the different parts to help you understand. If you're watching the tutorial online, you'll find a link to copy the expression in the video description. If you've downloaded the project files, you can find the expression in the resources folder of the project files or in the 403 reference composition. Okay, so at this point you've probably grabbed the expression. I have it right here in Sublime Text, so I'm gonna select all of the text and copy, Control or Command C, and then I'm gonna navigate back to After Effects, and we need a property to paste this to. So with the rocket layer selected, I'm gonna go to Layer, Time, Enable Time Remapping. And now we have a new Time Remap property on the timeline. So I'm gonna hit tilde on my keyboard to full screen this, and come over and add a new expression to Time Remap. Now I'm going to drag this expression window down so we can kind of see what we're doing. And I'm going to hit Control or Command V to paste the expression. The only line you should really need to edit is this first line. So in this case, the first line is correct on mine. You may need to update yours depending on what you named that layer. And I'm gonna go ahead and walk through this expression really quick. So this first line is looking for the composition called Rocket because that's the name of the current layer. And then inside of that, it's looking for the layer called Markers. The next line sets an initial value for the number of markers which will be redefined later. The next conditional statement checks to see if there are any markers on the layer. If there are, it's going to redefine n as the index of that marker. Now the next conditional statement right here sets the time remapping to 0 if it doesn't detect any markers. Now the next conditional statement is a pretty complex block of code. And this is basically a series of conditions that compares the comment value of the previous marker with comments inside of the nested composition. If it detects a match between the two comment names, it's going to change the time remapping value based on the marker's time of the matching comment. The nested conditional statement here ensures that once a scene has played through, it pauses at the end and waits for another marker rather than play through the rest of the scenes in sequence. Catch is included to suppress errors and to set time remapping to 0 if markers don't match up. So now everything looks good here and it's applied to the property. So I'm gonna click outside of the expression window and collapse this up and hit tilde to collapse this back down. So now we're back in the composition and we're at 2 seconds in time, but time remap is at 1 second. And that's because the fin close animation starts at second one inside of the rocket composition and animates for 1 second. So for simplicity's sake, I'm gonna hide the planet layer just so we can focus on the rocket. And if you preview the scene, the fins close right at the 2 second mark where the marker is placed. You can now add new markers that match the scene names. So for example, at second four, I can come up to layer, add marker, double click, fin, open as the name, and hit okay. And now the fins will open right at the 4 second mark. I can come over to second 7, for example, highlight the rocket layer, go to layer, add marker, double click on the marker, and call this one laser shoot, and then hit OK. And now if you preview, you'll see the laser coming out of the ship right at second 7. You can add some position keyframes, layer markers to trigger specific animations, add some rotation, scale keyframes, easing, some more layer markers, and now you have a finished animation, complete with complex nested animations triggered with simple layer markers. We've arrived at the end of lesson 403, using markers on the timeline to trigger animations. If you enjoy this expressions course, consider purchasing the paid content. It includes in-depth documentation, extra tutorial content, high-definition videos, and all the project files used in the training. Your purchase will help to create more free courses like this in the future.